Thank you. Afternoon. Thank you for being here. We are thrilled that you're here on this very special day in the state of Minnesota. We know that you're here because you either knew or knew of or experienced some relationship with a woman who we has become known as the woman of the century. Now, for those of us, particularly the school kids, that was the last century. But we are thrilled that you're all in our midst today, and it's going to be a whirlwind program because you see on your chair that it's a pretty long list of politicians that are being asked just limit their comments to 2 or 3 minutes. So we'll see how that goes. So it's a glorious day in Minnesota. You saw on your way here, it's bright sunshine. It is totally blue sky. It is the time when it is perfect in Minnesota for us to honor a very special woman. Now, the very first opportunity we have to share with you is to make this an official day. So our first official, our first educator, our first coach, our first cheerleader is Governor Tim Walz. Governor.
Thank you, Louise. Well, thank you, Louise, and thank you to all of you. It just feels right to be in this space, in the People's House, as Louise said, on this beautiful day, to be surrounded by young people, to be surrounded by educators and labor leaders, to be surrounded by the people who this place is for. And I think as the teacher in me, as the parent in me, the social studies teacher, that here we are in 2022, and we get the opportunity to add to our history in this space of this incredible human being. Having the statue in the history of Nellie Stone Johnson in here, the impact this will have on generations to come, the idea that this is a state that we need to tell our history, our inclusive and whole history of who we are, and to have this statue in this place to, as you heard, connect so many things that have made Minnesota great is a true honor. So my job today is, again, to listen to Louise, who said keep it short, but more importantly, to thank Nellie Stone Johnson's family who's here, to clearly understand that the state recognizes the state of Minnesota today was so enhanced and made so much better because of this incredible woman's life, and the opportunity for us to make sure that future generations feel and understand that impact. So it's my privilege today to be able to proclaim today, November 21st, 2022, as Nellie Stone Johnson Day in the state of Minnesota. Louise? I'd now like to hand it over to my partner in justice and someone who I think Minnesota has seen carving her path in this state of making sure voices are lifted up. That's our incredible Lieutenant Governor, Peggy Flanagan.
I'm going to use this box. Thank you, Louise. Thank you, Governor, and I'm so excited to be here with all of you today. I know this has been a labor of love and has been a long time coming. What a way for us to honor the memory and the legacy and the many contributions to the state of Minnesota that Nellie Stone Johnson has made. This has led to a lot of thinking over the last 4 years about the impact our choices on the people and ideas commemorated in this building and out on the mall on all of us. And it makes me proud to say that today marks the culmination of the choice that Nellie Stone Johnson should be honored in this building, in our house, in the people's house. In addition to the history that the governor shared, the statue itself brings a number of firsts of its own and is a big deal. It is the first new statue placed in our state capitol building in over 60 years. This is the first plaque, statue, or bust of a woman of color in the Capitol building. And it is a national first, the first statue authorized by government action of a black woman in any of our nation's state capitals. So this edition is a very long time in the making, and I am grateful for all of you who are here, all of your contributions, your generous contributions of time and funds to make this statue a reality. It really took the work of an incredible group of people that was sort of ever growing and tending to this to get us here today. So he is unable to join us today, but first I would like to recognize Tim Cleary, the sculptor whose work on the statue you will see shortly. Next, I would like to thank Paul Mandel. Paul Mandel, who prior to his retirement helped the statue toward completion as executive secretary of the CAP board. And Paul, I believe Louise has a token of appreciation also to present to you.
Not just one, Paul. Paul stuck with us through thick and thin in the beginning. Paul always called us back together when we thought that wasn't possible. Paul always did the right thing to get to where we are today, got us started, got us along very far along the way, but then he had the audacity to retire. So we weren't at his retirement party, so we are adding today to his collection on his wall in his office at his home. Paul Mandel, Executive Secretary, Capital Area Architectural and Planning Board, thank you for 34 years of skill, diplomacy, dedication to the state of Minnesota, its Capitol building and grounds, Nellie Stone Johnson, Statue Committee 2022. Yeah, yeah. And.
But wait, there's more.
There's more. We just can't let him go with something that hangs on the wall. This he can hang on his back. This is a t-shirt that commemorates Minnesota statehood 1858. To 1958, and here is a bag with the Minnesota seal to carry it all in, and we add our many, many thanks for your work and encouragement.
There was some fabulous prizes in the middle of this presentation. No cars. Don't look under your seat. There's nothing there. I would also like to note my appreciation for the work of our current excellent CAP Board Executive Secretary, Merritt Clapp Smith, and my fellow board members as well. Hi, Merritt. Thank you. I'm also grateful for Commissioner Robert Stavis and the team at the Department of Administration for all of their work as well. And finally, I would like to recognize the Statue Committee, Peg Carpenter, Judy Olson, Representative Joe Mullery, Tamara Tademe, Frank Vigiano, and Louise Sundin as the chair. And the state appropriation in 2013 laid the bedrock to allow for this statue. Then your persistent fundraising efforts and the generosity of Minnesotans, especially Minnesota's unions and their members who helped bring us today's celebration. So thank you. Now, when our students are visiting the Capitol, they are going to see and learn about the legacy of Nellie and all she represents. They are going to see themselves reflected in the People's House in a way they haven't before. And my mom was supposed to be at the celebration today. I lost my mom on Friday. And she really wanted to be here, because growing up, my mom went to Nellie's house after school. And my mom would bring, she was an amazing seamstress, and would bring items that needed to be mended or repaired, because we didn't have a lot. My mom's family didn't have a lot growing up, and she knew Nellie as an organizer, but also as my grandma's dear friend, who cared for her after school, who taught her so much. And today we are recognizing Nellie Stone as a woman who did so much for all of us. And if I may also just recognize my mom, who also is part of that legacy. So thank you for this opportunity. Excuse me. Thank you for this opportunity and for every little girl to know that she has a place and space in this building in whatever role she chooses. So, thank you. So this statue comes from the people of Minnesota and will now be trusted into the care of the Minnesota Historical Society. I will now hand things over to Minnesota Historical Society Executive Committee member and past president Phyllis Goff, who will share more on this. Thank you so much.
As immediate past president of the Minnesota Historical Society's Governing Board, the Executive Council, I'm proud to be here to share with you our pride in being a part of this occasion. The Minnesota Historical Society's mission is to preserve and share the stories of all Minnesotans. So we are especially honored to be a part of this historic moment in our state's history. Under state law, the Historical Society is responsible for both preservation and education at the Minnesota State Capitol. Therefore, we are pleased and proud to provide stewardship of this magnificent work of art on behalf of the people of Minnesota for the educational benefit of all Minnesotans who visit this amazing historic tribute in our state's historic Capitol building. I am personally proud and humbled and honored because I knew Nellie Stone Johnson and I looked up to her for her quiet but steady leadership, her strength, and her courage in fighting for workers and in fighting for the cause of equity and civil rights, not only in this state, but in the entire country. So on behalf of Kent Wentworth, the director and CEO of the Minnesota Historical Society, David Hakensons, the board president, and the entire board and staff of the Minnesota Historical Society, we thank you.
So we're all in this place today, really because of one man. And it was his friendship with Nellie, it was his knowledge of her life, it was his desire to memorialize her life, a life of activism, a life of commitment, a life of education, and it was a long journey for him. It's been a long journey for all of us, but most of all, it's been a long journey for the one who could conceive of this idea, who ushered it through, who kept his nose to the grindstone, if you will, and he's the reason that we, and the person we have to thank for being here today, and he's our friend, Joe Mullery, former representative. Joe.
Thank you all, and yes, it's been a while, and thank you, Louise. And Louise knows me and how well I know Nellie, so she said, you're gonna write out a script and stick to it, because otherwise we'll be here for days and maybe weeks, because you can tell Nellie stories forever. And the truth is, Nellie was a person of great character, but she was also a real character. So I actually worked on this all day yesterday to cut it in half, so I came in 2 minutes under what Louise gave me. So we finally come together to celebrate and honor my close friend Nellie Stone Johnson, who for a couple decades I've called probably the woman of the century in Minnesota, because she accomplished so much for so many varieties of people. People of color, workers, union members, women, educators, farmers, the list goes on. And while she became a leader on extremely varied initiatives, she told me over and over that they all sprouted from her clarion call that, to quote her, what everyone needs is an equal opportunity to a good job, a good education, and a good job. If someone never heard that from her, they never got into a deep discussion of her basic beliefs, because she repeated it every time she talked to me about issues. There were other issues for her, but she felt that most of them would be solved in the long run with good education and job. I started this project early in 1997 and thought it would be done in a year or two. Instead, it's been 2 months short of 26 years. When I was a new legislator in 1997, I started looking around the Capitol while I was waiting for meetings. I soon noticed there were no statues or busts of blacks from Minnesota. Then I noticed there were none of women. Then I noticed there were none of workers or union leaders or educators or farmers. Basically politicians, mostly. And I thought to myself, how do the people of Minnesota relate to the people honored in the Capitol? What we really need here is a real role model. And I thought about who we could have busts or statues of. I immediately thought of Nellie as clearly the leading civil rights leader. And as I started thinking of others to represent a variety of people, I realized Nellie was sort of an all-in-one. She had done a great amount of work for women in the workplace. She was known all over the state for her fiery oratory and accomplishments for workers and union rights. And she was a leader on both College for All as well as job training. And on top of everything, she always still remembered she was an armed girl and fought for them. So I introduced a bill for a bus for Nellie. After I talked to two powerful Iron Range legislators, they really liked the backing that she had always done for the unions and being a union leader. And the bill sailed through the House and all the committees and in the Senate, but at the last minute it was blocked in the Senate. But I wasn't going to give up, as you can see. Finally, I kept trying and trying, and in 2014 budget year, 18 years later, I got cooperation from both houses and the governor. And we got what is believed to be the first law in the country to put a statue of a black woman in the state capitol. And the reason I asked Senator Lantz to author the bill in the Senate is, as usual, Nellie had a lot of connections. She had told me many years before that Ron Lantz's grandfather and his dad were political close friends of hers and were in the same group on the North Side political fights as she was, way back in the 50s, et cetera. 40s, 30s. And a big selling point to legislators was convincing them that a statue along with a big plaque setting forth all Nellie had done would be a great role model effect on everyone, but especially students, and within students, especially women and those of color. Then we had to raise the money for the statue. Thank God for the unions. They understood how important it is for working people and students to come to the Capitol and be inspired by seeing someone like them. The unions contributed by far the most money, and who was the leader on that? Right there, Louise did a great job on getting all the union money. And so now we have the fifth statue of a real person and the first real person statue since around 1914. So think about that, it's over 100 years. When I think about Nellie, I think about what an incredible life she had. One of the first indicators are actual conversations I've had with staff at her nursing home. I'll never forget this, the first time it happened to me there. It had happened earlier at 314 Hennepin and other places she lived in different ones. But one evening when I was visiting Nellie at the nursing home, some of the staff were gathered and one said to me, "You know, Joe, that old woman you're always visiting has the wildest imagination. She tells all sorts of obviously false tales about herself, being involved with a lot of the most powerful people in our state and nationally, and about getting all sorts of things done for minorities and women and workers and for better education. To top it off, what's even more amazing, Joe, is she says it the same way every time, never changing details. And that's really tough when you're making things up." And I said, "Well, if you look at everything she was involved with and accomplished, you would have a good argument for calling her the woman of the century in Minnesota." And I asked what they were talking about. So the first woman said, "Well, Nellie claimed she was a close friend of two vice presidents of the United States, Humphrey and Mondale. And she claimed she worked closely with them on legislation and get Humphrey elected. How ridiculous is that?" And she even tells stories claiming she went around Africa with Mondale. So I said to them, "You know something? That's all true." When Humphrey first knew I was from the north side of Minneapolis, this is Hubert, not Skip, back in 1971, he immediately started talking about his great friend from the north side, and how Nellie, and how she helped him learn civil rights, workers, and union issues, and how she helped him get support from the unions and from blacks. His son, Skip, right here, who was our attorney general, will be up here next to tell you more. And Mondale, whenever I asked for something for him, for help for Nellie or one of her programs, like her scholarship, he said, "I'll do anything for Nellie." And he said she helped him on civil rights and voting issues. And yes, she did accompany him in Africa on his goodwill tour. And he told me that at all times, she, not his wife, but Nellie stood next to him and sat next to him at every meeting and every dinner and ceremony. And of course, I told them that she was also a friend of Governor Perpich. And then someone at the nursing home said, "Well, she surely didn't know Jackie Robinson and some big union leader from the East Coast who organized the March on Washington with Martin Luther King." So I informed them, yeah, she did know both of them. And she didn't like Jackie personally. She thought he was arrogant and stuck on himself, but she thought he was doing fantastic work for people. And the union leader, of course, was A. Philip Randolph, a black man who was part of the Porters Union and was the originator of what's called the Martin Luther King March on Washington. Nellie said that A. Philip Randolph was not only great and powerful, but was gracious to women and treated them as equals. And if you've studied the civil rights movement, there's a number of the great leaders, the men, that had the reputation of keeping women in the background. And so A. Philip Randolph was completely the opposite. So then I went on to tell the people at the nursing home a short brief of what she had done. Like I said, it would take hours to cover everything she did. But I talked to the people there at the nursing home about her slogan, what all people need is an equal opportunity to a good education, a good job, and why she fitted everything into that. And people mostly don't know. She was the one most responsible for getting Minneapolis to pass the first in the nation fair employment ordinance, and then later the fair housing ordinance. And later they were passed similar laws for the whole state, and the Minneapolis Civil Rights Commission and the Department of Human Rights came out of these. When she was working at the athletic club in Minneapolis, she faced both job discrimination because she was black and cutting wages for all their employers. People probably don't know, but her dad was an organizer for the Milk Producers Association of Minnesota when she was on his farm. So she understood the power of organizing. Her dad taught her well. So she decided to help organize the union at the MAG. She quickly rose within the union to be one of the first women vice presidents, contract negotiators. And then she became a force at the Central Labor Union and pushed through positions demanding the end to discrimination against blacks and women, and the first resolution was for the Minneapolis School Board to do that. And that came out of the union movement before the NAACP or Urban League pushed it. Eventually, she rose to being on the governing boards of the Central Labor Union and the state AFL-CIO, and she was, of course, a close friend at the time of three heads of the Minnesota AFL-CIO, as well as the one to become head next. Within the political realm, she also achieved great success. She was the first black person elected to Minneapolis government. Think about that. First person in history in Minneapolis. And she was in demand as an orator around the state for organized workers and for civil rights, as I mentioned, and a leader in the Farmer Labor Party. She and Hubert Humphrey, who was the leader of the Democratic Party, were close personal friends, even though they had the biggest fights and arguments that have probably ever existed in this world, but they were such close personal friends and believed in each other, they always worked it out. And the two of them got together. She was with the wing of the Farmer Labor Party that did not want to merge back then into the DFL, but Hubert got her to bring them in, and so that's why we have the DFL party in Minnesota. She later rose to the executive committee of the DFL and became national committee woman for the Democratic Party, and she was instrumental in the party's Black Caucus. And what almost nobody knows is she was the Minnesota representative on the National Democratic Party's Agriculture Committee. She never forgot her roots on the farm. And then she never gave up. When she was in her mid-70s, she recruited and ran the campaign to elect the first black council member in Minneapolis. And of course, she was active in national civil rights and black organizations, and I won't go into all of that. She was on the executive board 26 years. Of the NAACP. Well, one thing that I think is of note is that she and a few other black union activists within the NAACP were constantly harping on Thurgood Marshall. As you all know, he was later US Supreme Court judge. They said he wasn't aggressive enough on handling discrimination and segregation cases, and he better get his butt going. If you knew Nellie, that was easy for her to do. In closing, it's impossible to remember all the vast number of initiatives Nellie led, but the most important thing for everyone to remember is her character. She had a deep-seated passion to help everyone in need, as she called it, a sense of humanity, and she wanted everyone treated alike. She hated racism and tribalism, no matter where it was coming from. And she couldn't stand dwelling on the past. She wanted all focus on the present and future, namely, how do we make everyone a success in life? She was proud of Also, the fact that she never stopped learning, even on issues where she had taken a leading position. She told me many times she had changed her mind on an issue, either because she gave a deeper consideration or learned new facts or concepts. And above all, she cared more about helping others than herself. Nellie turned down many lucrative jobs, including in the federal court system, because she wanted to contribute to her charge on helping humanity, despite the fact it kept her at a low income. If she ran her own shop, she could take off whenever she wanted. She didn't have to answer to an employer on any of her union or political positions. I would say she's the personification of what a good citizen can accomplish. Almost all Minnesotans, no matter what their role is, can relate to her and strive to help others. And people, especially students, can read her story on the plaque and be inspired to follow in her footsteps. I'll always remember another thing about her at that nursing home. When I visited her in the nursing home one morning, she was too sick to even sit up. I told her that her union was picketing the new owners of the athletic club where she first got her started in the union. She leaned over rolled over onto one elbow and said, "You go down there and tell my union and brothers and sisters to give them hell for Nellie." That's just plain Nellie. And with that, I turn the mic over to Skip Humphrey, Hubert's son, who was our great attorney general and later the national head of the American Association of Retired Persons. Nellie and Hubert had enormous arguments, as I said, but they recognized the greatness in each other, and working together, they accomplished tremendous things for Minnesotans. Skip?
Thank you, Joe, the governor, lieutenant governor, and friends. It's wonderful to be here. The story about Nellie is just very special. Here is a woman who was able to do all those things, and if you were sitting next to her, like I was on occasion, on a bus, you were being told what to do next. I mean, it was a matter of, she had this sense of wholeness, of understanding of where we needed to go, but it was always, how are you going to get there? How are you going to make it happen? And so it is indeed an honor to be here. I will attempt to contain the Humphrey genes for long speeches. My good friends that are here know that I don't have the capacity that certain other gentlemen in our family had. But let me just say a couple of things, because I don't want to forget some of these things. This is a story, you've heard what Nellie has done. If there's one word that I think fits her better than anything else, yes, she was able to protest. She was able to stand up and say, no, this isn't right. But there was always this other commitment. What are you going to do about it? How are you going to get it done? She was a doer. And if you look at the record that she has, that she accumulated, it was about getting the job done. And she helped drag this state and, frankly, this nation forward. We need more of that today. Let me just tell you a couple of things. I was told by Joe 4 minutes, and I won't even make them 4 Humphrey minutes, okay? I remember Nellie as almost my other political mother. She seemed to be always caring for me, and whatever activity, concern, political ambition, political activity I was engaged in. And this was all throughout my political career, from the time that I ran for state senate and served with Mr. Moe and others, all the way through. And then after that, too. And the same goes for Nellie's care and watching over my wife, Lee. I can still see very clearly Nellie and Lee sitting in a bus, chatting and organizing while we were on the road to one or another meeting event. She was always there. Yes, she had this larger aura about her, but it was always personal for her. She really was engaged with the individuals who she was dealing with at the time. Nellie just had that personal, engaging, caring sense and touch about her. Nellie, as at the core of, she was at the core of transformation of Minnesota's path to a brighter and better racial history. And she did it through the hard work of her labor organizing, labor action. If you look at all the organizations that she was involved with, you would say, well, wow, this woman is not only something, but she was a bit of a terror around. But the thing is, she used those organizations, and at the core of it was labor. She used it to make sure that working people had better conditions, a better life. That was her goal. And it was not only her personal goal, but it was the public goal she had. And whenever those organizations seemed to veer off, and you look at those organizations, you say, oh my goodness gracious, Communist Party, Socialist, this and all that. As soon as she sensed that things weren't going the direction that she knew they had to go, she was on another tangent, organizing others to make sure that they were moving ahead in the right direction. And that's really takes something to do. Just a couple of other things. She wouldn't let you say no, that we can't do it. It was always something that she said, oh, I think you can find a way. That meant she was going to check up on you. She always had a persistent way to get the job and the better job done. Now, if my father were here today, we would be here till tonight, but Dad would tell you how Nellie Stone Johnson was just as persistent with him as with any of us, and perhaps even more. And I think Joe mentioned it. If you see the parallel, and Joe, I gotta tell you, your words were really hit home. The fact was they did have arguments, but it was arguments about how we do this better, how are we going to pull it together, who do we need to have, how do we organize? And at the core of that, of course, her involvement with labor. And a knowledge also of farming and all of that. She was indeed a partner with Dad in his quest for civil rights. And she was willing to stay and say, no, you need to go this way. She didn't have any problem telling him what the right direction was. She was a key player in the merging of the Farmer Labor Party with the Democratic Party, as you have heard. And I love her history of joining whatever organization that would promote and create a better working conditions for the working men and women of our state. And we've gone through that, whether it was FDR, be considered a hero, Dad, Mondale, NAACP, Farmer Labor Party, Communist Party, Socialist Party, and on, yet when it came to these organizations that live up to Nellie's expectations, then her demand for real positive change kind of got into her, and she said, I've got to go another direction. I've got to do another thing. Nellie, you have been a worker, a supporter, and even more a friend, and a mentor, and a solid advisor to me, our Humphrey family. Thank you for your care. Thank you for your investment of your good and kind service to our state and to our nation and to the world. Let me just say there's one word that comes to mind when I think of Nellie Stone Johnson and how she fits into the progress of our state. Reconciliation. She will expect us to acknowledge our past, to use it as a foundation for changing for a better future, and she will say, get on it, Humphrey, get on it, friends, get organized, get it working.
Thank you, Skip. As you said, had it been another Humphrey that I was introducing, it we'd still be here when the food was done. But thank you for your powerful statements. Now, speaking of power, Dr. Tamrat Tademi is one of the oldest best friends of Nellie's, and has probably done more in funding, in talking, in teaching about Nellie of anybody in the state or nation. He teaches about Nellie in his classes at St. Cloud State University. He is a professor there, and he also inspires all of us to do more to recognize her and memorialize her. And so, will you share with a couple of thoughts why you have put so much in?
Oops. I am the type of individual that doesn't like being pegged to a lectern. I like to move around. C'est la vie, that won't happen now. And I have lost my voice. I was wearing my mask, and my sister here said, don't do that, please, because you don't look good with a mask on. So I had to listen to my sister. First of all, I want to tell everybody how proud I am to have been on the same planet as Nellie Stone Johnson. I also want to express my deepest condolences to my sister, the Lieutenant Governor, because I lost my mom, and it's very painful. Now, let's see if I can compose myself. But anyway, to me, what does Nellie mean? Nellie means love. Nellie means multidimensional brilliance. Nellie means organic brilliance, not a brilliance that you read and artificially produce out of a book. She had a sense of humanness that could only come out of where she came from. Her beautiful father, William Allen, and her mother, the Allens, that family is a fantastic family and an inspiring one. William Allen was a 21st century human being, and so is Nellie. I want to make a slight correction. She's not only a person of the 20th century, because most of the issues we are struggling with right now were what Nellie was talking about. Whether it's employment, whether it's racial justice, police, whatever, the terror we feel, the incompleteness we feel, everything was right here with us. So with Nellie, there's always a call for emancipation, a call to do better. So I hope my beautiful brother, all right, the governor, my beautiful sister, and all of you sisters and brothers, I hope you listen to Nellie's call. I hope you don't shelve her in a statue there and leave it there. We have to listen to a call to do for this state. I don't want this to be a ritual, which is why I did what I could, thanks to the folks in St. Cloud. And I had an amazing president, may he rest in peace, by the name Robert. And by the way, talking about St. Cloud, I want to shout out to my sisters and brothers from St. Cloud. There's a brother here by the name Shahzad Ahmad. Nellie used to call him her Pakistani son. And Frank Vigiano was her Italian son. And by the way, the reason why I was able to raise all this money is because I have a loving, beautiful family. My partner, Karen Shannon, who had to go to the doctors. This is a crazy time, as you know, and she couldn't come. I would never have been able to do what I could for raising this money without the support of my family. Nothing is individually driven, it's collective. And Yes, I am dedicated to Nelly. Yes, I've raised money, but that would never have been possible if it wasn't for the loving family I had. Nelly Stone Johnson was a household name. We got so close. How did we get to become close? Obviously, again, not through nonsense, not through ticky-tacky nonsense. Nelly is not a ticky-tacky nonsense person. But Nelly and I used to joke about, I was crazy about berets. In fact, I brought it here, but I don't want to take too much time. I used to wear berets. I can barely speak berets, as you know, the beret, chapeau, all right? And I used to wear leather berets. And my family used to laugh at me because I would sleep on the couch with my leather beret on. That's how maniacal I was with my berets. So Nelly and I used to go shopping. She loved berets. And I would say, Nelly, let's go and get some berets. And I say, why don't you get a leather one like me so that we can both look cute? And she would say, no, that's too bougie for me. I want the woolen beret. And she got that. And anyway, she was so special. So we'd get all that stuff. We'd laugh with each other. And then I started to realize the magic she had on people. What happened is with Robert Bayes, we were able to give her a doctorate, an honorary doctorate with letters of humanities. Nelly got in 1996 from St. Cloud State. She shared that honor with the great Walter Mondale, the late Walter Mondale, who was the ambassador to the United States at that time. Both of them got an honorary doctorate in humanities with letters from St. Cloud State. St. Cloud State loved Nelly. Nelly brought emancipation and healing to many of us. We started fighting for racial justice in the early 90s. Nelly would show up all the time to empower us, to heal us, to encourage us. And Nelly was definitely an amazing human being. One last thing I wanted to say, just to tell you how much people loved her. I found out that Nelly passed away, and I used to walk around Lake of the Isles to ease from my stress from St. Cloud State. Anyway, and don't get me wrong, there are a lot of good people also at St. Cloud State. Anyway, and Shahzad, one of them. Anyway, so here it is. I was walking around Lake of the Isles, and I get a call. Nelly just transitioned. Nelly just passed from Judy or somebody, because we're very close. So I told, I was walking around the lake. Walter Mondale used to love walking around Lake of the Isles. In fact, I used to walk around with him. He had a dog called Nietzsche. Nietzsche was his dog. It could almost make a comedy. Tamrat, Nietzsche, and Walter. Anyway, so I would love walking around with Nietzsche and him. He taught me a lot, the great vice president of ours. And I told Walter, Fritz, used to love him and say, brother, Nelly just transitioned. And her celebration is going to be at the cathedral, the Breck School Cathedral tomorrow. He said, Brother Tamrat, I'll be there. And he was. He was in the front seat together with Bernie Brammer, the great union leader president, and the other union leader. We sang Solidarity Forever. We cried together. Mark Dayton was there. Paul Wellstone was there. And my brother Skip was there. And just one last thing, I know, before I get dragged out, I'm talking forever too. My brother, Walter got up, Honorable Walter Mondale got up to speak, and he said, when he was in Africa with Nelly, he didn't know by the time she finished what was happening in Nigeria. Automatically, Nelly understood the contradiction of Nigerian society, the skewed wealth at the top and the poverty. She said she would get into meetings and she would pound the table. She thought she was going to recruit all the Nigerians to the DFL party. That's how brilliant she was. Anyway, I love you all. I'm going to do what I can so long as I'm alive to do what is real for Nelly. All of us in this room pledge not only to celebrate her statue, but to do what is right for our community. I love you all. Do what's right for education, Governor. Thank you.
Thank you. You hear the passion. Now you know why he continues to do what he does to support everything Nelly and to teach everything Nellie. So now, sister, how proud Nellie would have been, how thrilled she would have been to be able to introduce sister president of the AFL-CIO. So, Sister Bernie Burnham, please, as an educator, but also now as a woman leader of our unions in the state of Minnesota, tell us how we were able to end up with a statue.
Yay. Well, you know, I didn't know Nellie, but all the stories I've heard already today, I feel like I know her better. And I'm with you, Dr. Tademi. We need to live in her way, and the way she did things. Representative Mullery, thank you for starting an idea. That's how all great things happen, right? But we know that it takes some money for ideas to come to fruition. So if you take a look at the back of your program, this lists all of the unions and all the individuals who have donated thus far. And I am proud to be here, and I was going to say, Louise, you know, it's interesting. I think, obviously, Nellie laid the foundation for me to be where I'm standing today, too. So thanks, everybody, for being here, and take a look. Thank you for the donations, and we'll move forward in Nellie's way. All right.
See, there's somebody that learned from an English teacher, brevity is the soul of wit, right? All right, all right. So now we have another medium that we have you attend to, and that is a video. This is a short version of what will end up being a much longer version of her entire life. This is a short version of how we got here today. And the Labor Education Service, University of Minnesota, John C. is the producer and director and everything else behind this great work. And so please take a look at the TV screen.
We shall not be moved. We passed that ordinance for equal opportunity for jobs.
Finally, a female civil rights activist is slated to be honored in the Capitol.
We have a Nellie Johnson statue that is, had $30,000 in a state appropriation a few years ago, and they have privately fundraised the balance of about $110,000. That'll go in the North Corridor on the first floor. There are a few bays that are a slightly raised floor on the sides, and that'll be a life-size statue of Nellie Stone Johnson.
When I first got to the Capitol, after being elected, I had a lot of time waiting for meetings or waiting in breaks, and so I was wandering around and looking at all the items in the Capitol, and I realized there weren't any of any blacks from Minnesota. That was the first thing I thought about, and then I quickly saw that there wasn't any women either recognized, and then there was nothing of a farmer, nothing of a worker, union or non-union worker. There was no educator. There just wasn't anybody. And so I started thinking we needed something so that this capital starts reflecting the people of the state. And then the more I thought about it, well, Nellie was, you know, she grew up on a farm. She always was fighting to be for farmers and part of the Farmer Labor Party that she was raised in. She always preached to me about what my people need is a equal opportunity to a good education and a good job. So as you looked at it, just about everything that I was thinking of we were missing at the Capitol, she was a part of and a major player in all of those things. And it's so basically that's why I decided on she was the perfect person for a statue. That was in 1997 when I was first elected, and so I pretty soon that session I started, got it through the House that year, and it made through all the committees in the Senate, and then it was taken out at the last instant on the floor of the Senate. Every year I would float it and talk to people. And then finally in 2014, people started saying, well, maybe we should do that. We finally got the bill passed, and I believe it's the first law passed in any legislature in the country to put a black woman statue in the state capitol.
Even though I thought I was pretty smart politically, because my father, I always said, was the best teacher in the world, but on the other hand, when I stopped to think how little I really did know, and things began to come to me, and then I studied more and more history, and then a lot of the historical stuff that happened in politics right here in Minnesota, as well as the, that's how I got onto more of the history of the Nonpartisan League, which my father believed in.
The movement's focus on economic issues brought people together across powerful racial and ethnic divides. African American farmers became active members of the League. Labor and civil rights leader Nellie Stone Johnson was born to William Allen, a farmer, and Gladys Allen, a teacher, in 1905. She grew up on farms in Minnesota's Dakota and Pine Counties.
My dad was a member of the Nonpartisan League. I was very familiar with the League and read many of the papers. I was 13 doing the distribution of literature to the farmers. I just propped the material up on the horse's saddle horn so I could read it.
Nellie Allen had been fired in 1924 for talking about having a union at the elite Minneapolis Athletic Club, where she worked as the employee elevator operator. The climate for organizing had changed when she got her job back in 1934. She organized the workers who got on and off her elevator.
You secretly organized some unions, and you know, I know it was very rough because they were, you know, throwing injunctions at people and they were firing people.
I got fired a couple of times too. That was the Minneapolis Athletic Club, and those private clubs were very powerful. They're economically very powerful, and socially, if it was on the economics, certainly on the social side of things. So, and labor was not one of the organizations or a group of people that was well liked by people of power at that time. That's just about the same as people that were black.
It was working the service elevator. Well, at the same time, my grandfather, George Naumoff, was working the freight elevator. And he was a guy who thought the working conditions could be a lot better there. He wanted to be able to get people to organize and show their power. This was like a year after the big Teamsters strike, the bloody Teamsters strike in Minneapolis, and the Teamsters won. People were really enthusiastic after that. And he was fired up and thinking we should do something for the Hotel and Restaurant Workers Union. Now, the strategy was a brilliant one. My grandfather was operating the freight elevator, and Nellie was operating the service elevator. The two of them had perfect captive audiences as the employees went up and down in their elevators, the 14 floors. So they talked to them. They talked to them about how they were essential workers, that they were important. They were as important as the managers. And in fact, the Minneapolis Athletic Club could not operate without them. They did everything that was essential there. And you know, they did a really good job. People signed up, even though they were scared. They knew that they could get fired. They knew that there was a lot at risk here because there were no other jobs. But they trusted Nellie and my grandfather.
Nellie took the challenge to make change. In the 1930s, she helped form unions that protected workers' rights. In the 1940s, she helped form the Democratic Farmer Labor Party, or DFL, a model of the nation's Democratic Party. She was a friend and advisor to a young Hubert Humphrey, who went on to become Minneapolis mayor, senator, and vice president. Nellie became the first African-American elected to public office in the city of Minneapolis when she was voted onto the city's library board.
A lot of things happened to our family because my father was very active in politics. And then my father, in 1913, was elected on the school board in Dakota County. And that was good for us to have that picture to see that it could be done. And he was always talking politics of the average working person, and of course that included the family type farmer, which we were. It's kind of hard work, but I didn't like it. I always liked hard work because like it made me very healthy.
Did you ever have any fears being so politically active as a woman and also as a woman of color?
Yes, during the labor movement back in the 30s, because people didn't make any difference what nationality you were or what color, that there was a lot of feeling, and it was not very nice. It wasn't a very humane feeling for people in labor. A lot of people got killed, got manned, hurt, what have you.
You said that your father was active in politics. Was he the one that drew you to politics?
Yeah, I liked what he was doing because he was powerful where we were, you know, and everybody came there for advice, things like that, and I heard some of those conversations around the table. It seemed like he was always loaded with dessert dishes and certainly coffee cups and saucers clear across the lengthwise and things like that. So I think it kind of stays with you. This is, you see powerful things happening.
Nellie was a trailblazer unlike any other. She was one of the first women to sit on her local's contract negotiating committee. She was one of the first women vice president of the Minnesota Culinary Council and Local 665, the Hotel and Restaurant Employees Union. When she won a seat on the library board in 1945, she was the first Black person elected to citywide office. Minnesota, and she helped to spearhead the passage of Minnesota's Fair Employment and Fair Housing Laws of 1955 and 1957. So let me be very clear, when Black women lead, we all win. Visionaries like Nellie and their radical imaginations understood how education was a path to economic security for Black, Indigenous, and people of color, including women. So as Lieutenant Governor, there's not a long list there's not a long job description. But what is in statute is that the Lieutenant Governor is the chair of the CAP board. And as a Minnesotan, I am super excited to announce the formal welcome of the Nellie Stone Johnson statue to our state capitol building. And let me be clear, this is a really big deal. This is the first plaque or statue or bust of a woman of color in the Capitol building. When I walk into the Capitol, I often do two things. I take one breath where I acknowledge the tremendous responsibility and opportunity that I have in this role as Lieutenant Governor, but I take a second breath, which is a breath of protection. Going into a system that wasn't created by us or for us, but in many ways was created to silence or eliminate us. And her spirit will be in that place where it belongs as we hold the door wide open for women of color, for young girls who will be able to see themselves for the first time reflected in that place and space, and it is a very big deal.
What would you want your legacy to be?
Well, I think that jobs and education, I'd like people to pay some attention to that, and that goes across the board for all people, regardless of race, creed, color, national origin. That's some of the wordage that we put in at the state level for the legislation.
I just want you to know what a pleasure it was for you to be here with us and talk to us and answer all of our questions. So you are a positive force, and we just want to thank you very much for being here.
Well, I want to thank you for having the nerve to invite me here. I tell you, I'm noted politically as one of those wild women out there. Rural people, so.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, will you come on up? I want to just call your attention to a sheet that was on the chairs of some of you. I hope the rest of you picked it up. On the back, it says, Farmer Labor Movement Documentary. This isn't it. There's another wonderful documentary, longer, which was produced by Randy Croce, Tom O'Connell, and Anna Kernajic as creative producers. It is available to show in classes, all you educators, at organizations, all you union leaders, political meetings, and it and the location of where to find it is on this sheet. And it talks about the parallels between historic conflicts and contemporary conflicts. So take a look at that, please. On the other side, while Ken Martin is speaking, if the labor chorus would come up this direction while he's, and in the meantime, I am very pleased, and I think we all are, to introduce and have just share a very uncharacteristically brief also statement about how the state of Minnesota is proudly the Democratic Farmer Labor Party. Director and Chair, Ken Martin.
Thank you, Governor, Lieutenant Governor, distinguished guest. Good afternoon. I am truly honored to be with all of you today to unveil this statue of one of Minnesota's great leaders and one of the founders of this party, which I have the distinct honor of leading, the Minnesota Democratic Farmer Labor Party. Nellie Stone Johnson embodied the best of our values as Minnesotans and as DFLers: compassion, equality, fearlessness, and persistence. She was a champion for all Minnesotans, regardless of race, color, or creed. The daughter of a farmer, she mentored Hubert Humphrey on civil rights legislation and was the architect of what became the Minnesota Human Rights Department and the Minneapolis Civil Rights Commission. Johnson played an integral role in the forming of the Minnesota DFL Party, and her legacy stands as a guiding light for DFLers past, present, and future. In the 1920s and 30s, as you've already heard, Nellie Stone Johnson's father was a farmer and a co-op organizer in Pine County who got involved with the Farmer Labor Party. Even as a teenager, Nellie Stone Johnson was already active in organizing people. She would walk an 8-mile stretch in her neighborhood delivering farmers' rights literature to Scandinavian and Russian farmers. And Johnson saw how the Farmer Labor Party not only fought for farmers and union leaders, but she said the Farmer Labor Party was a melting pot that invited everyone to join, regardless of class, ethnicity, gender, or race. She recognized that we are at our strongest when we set aside our differences, we come together and fight for one another. She took this idea to heart and she led the charge to combine two great political parties, creating the Democratic Farmer Labor Party. In 1944, Nellie Stone Johnson, Hubert Humphrey, and Elmer Benson merged the Minnesota Democratic Party and the Minnesota Farmer Labor Party together, creating this historic coalition. Now, if you look back to 1944 or today in 2022, the values of Nellie Stone Johnson are still our party's North Star: compassion, equality, fearlessness, and persistence. The Democratic Farmer Labor Party, built by Nellie Stone Johnson, is an inclusive party that has led on civil rights, on economic justice, on fair wages, on voting rights, and is driven by union members, organizers, and activists who do the work day in, day out, talking to and finding out voters. So I hope that visitors to the Capitol will learn from and be inspired by her story and legacy when they see this statue. I know that I am. I will close with this. Even in her 90s, Nellie Stone Johnson wouldn't stop bringing people together to fight for a better life. She said, "I'm not going to quit. There's too much to do. People need jobs, equality, education. We still need to organize to learn how the economics and politics drive everything in life. Can't stop now." Nellie Stone Johnson never stopped. She kept fighting and, most importantly, organizing for the things she believed in. Our state, our country, the labor movement, and our Democratic Farmer Labor Party are better off because of Nellie Stone Johnson. Thank you so much.
So we have not been keeping track of the current legislators or recent past legislators who are here. So any legislators, recent or past, can you stand up so we can see you?
Representative Moran. Okay.
Rita Moran, Lyndon Carlson, Roger Moe.
I saw Jim Dabney was here.
Harry Dietzick was here, our new leader.
Jim Dabney.
Jim Dabney was here.
And Sandy Pepper.
And Sandy Pappas. So thank you all. You all played a wonderful role. And now you heard just say she never would quit. Now, on the back of that sheet that I mentioned to you are the words to a song that will hum in some people's head who are of an age. And it's Charlie and the MTA. You remember? Did he ever return? No, he never returned. Okay, so you got, come on in. Jody, keep coming. Okay, so some members of the Labor Chorus are here, and please sing along. You'll, after the first, stanza, you'll figure it out. Okay? And this is our esteemed author of the words. Yay! Yay.
Okay. Well, let me tell you the story of a woman named Nellie, born not too far from here. Her parents were farmers down in Lakeville, Minnesota, and that's where she was reared. Now her daddy taught her that working people must not stand alone. They got to hang together and speak with one voice, or surely they will hang alone. Did her daddy teach her? Yes, her daddy taught her, and she learned her lessons well. Working people got to stand together, or surely they will never do well. Nellie moved to Minneapolis when she was 20, looking for a job. Elevator operator was the job she landed at the athletic club. They cut the wages for all the workers. Nellie said, heck no! Organizing, educating, and motivating was the only way to go. Did she keep on fighting? Yes, she kept on fighting. She just didn't know how to quit. She organized the others into a union to fight the boss's greed. There was a group called the Farmer Labor Party, and another called the Democrats. Both were left to center and attracted the same voters, and that was kind of sad. If they came together to form one party, their power would increase. So Nellie worked with others to solve the issues, and the DFL came to be. Did she ever give up? No, she never gave up. She just didn't know how to quit. She worked for justice for working people. She just didn't know how to quit. So having formed a new party, Nellie then decided to run for library board. But this was Minneapolis, a very white city. It hadn't been done before. She won the election and served for 6 years promoting literacy. Believing good jobs are the key to justice and the way to end poverty. Did she run for office? Yes, she ran for office. She outvoted all the rest. First black woman to be elected in a citywide contest. Nellie's mantra was jobs and education. You've got to have both to thrive. Higher Education Board is where she got appointed, and this is what she cried. Dignity flows from the power of a paycheck, and pride follows right behind. If our country is to prosper, we gotta have good schools, not just for the first in line. Jobs and training, peace and justice, they just seem to go hand in hand. We all do better when we all do better, and Nellie said we should and can. We all do better when we all do better, and Nellie said we should and can.
Hey!
Okay, thank you. And now we have the chair of the board of directors of the Nellie Stone Johnson Scholarship, and T. McClenty, who is also on the board and our event chair. So if you guys will come up and just introduce and nothing else.
I said to Frank, I can go first. I'll be really fast. So as you know, Nellie Stone Johnson has given out scholarships over many years. So we would like to recognize former and current scholarship recipients. If you are in the room, please stand and be recognized. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my honor to be here, chair of Nellie Stone Johnson Scholarship. And most of it, I think we don't realize this goes back to 1987 when Nellie was actually on the board. And Tom Rett and others know that that was Chancellor Carruthers at the State University System who helped put together a scholarship, and many of us supported his efforts. And I have the worst job in the world here because I have to thank people. So I know there's going to be people that I'll miss. But just for the sake of thanking some of the people and realizing I'm going to miss some people, first I want to ask all my fellow board members from the Nellie Stone Johnson Scholarship to stand and be recognized. We have a very hard-working group of about 25 people, and they've all done a very good job. And of course, Louise is one example. Louise was on the board of trustees when we invited her to come on the board, and it's very unusual to have a trustee, you know, to come and serve on a committee like this. And we were very pleased, and it was probably the best decision we ever made asking her. And we really appreciate all the time that she's given. Well, I also want to especially thank Chancellor Devinder Malhotra, who's not here. He's with family in California from India. But he asked me to give his greetings and say his staff will be here and will support the efforts we're having. And also President Bernie Burnham, who's from the AFL-CIO. Thank you, Bernie. AFL-CIO has been, and the state, Minnesota State, have been critical partners along with the students and all the different labor unions and campuses over the years. And in the 35 or so years that we've been around, we've always had strong support. And we've never, even during the COVID years, we never had wavering support. So I really appreciate that from everybody. And if most of you might have seen it, but just in case you haven't, on the donors. And these are just donors that gave to the statue effort. And you can see a lot of them are just average Minnesotan types, many of them union members and educators. And they gave out of their pockets. And of course, Tamrat Dedemi, professor at St. Cloud, is our biggest individual donor, and over the years, I know we talked about it, but I still think it's worth recognizing again as our biggest donor and one of the reasons why the state is here today. And there's a number of legislators that are here. I know you Representative Carlson, former Senator Moe, former Representative Joe Mullery. Okay. Well, all right. My wife's over there. I do want to point out, we also, one of our biggest, latest donors is Affinity Plus Federal Credit Union. They were nice enough to give us a very generous gift. And Dave Larson, their president, is here with us. Dave, thank you for your support. And many of his members work in this building and in other state buildings as the former State Capital Credit Union. Being the credit union junkie that I am, I know that. Now, the last thing I want to mention is we had very long negotiations over the last couple of months, and I want to thank the Commissioner of Administration, Alice Roberts Davis. Commissioner, thank you for working with us to get through the last couple of months of this situation and to have us here all today. And finally, I just want to thank all of you that have given and contributed, not only monetarily, but with your time and efforts. And I really appreciate everything you've done for us and for the students, the hundreds and hundreds of students over the years that we've been able to give scholarships to and will continue to give scholarships to in the name of Nellie Stone Johnson. Thank you very much. Next, on behalf of the Minnesota State System, which is the universities and colleges in our state, the chair of the board, Roger Moe.
Governor, Lieutenant Governor, fellow Minnesotans, I'm so honored to be here today for this historic event and to honor someone who I called a friend and had the really good fortune to work with for many years. As has been mentioned, Chancellor Malhotra would have loved to have been here, but is out of town and sends his very best wishes. In addition to me, we have many from throughout the Minnesota state system who are here today. I hope they'll give a little wave when I mention their names. Trustee Jay Coles, Trustee Cheryl Teffer, Trustee Tim Hipsch, Normandale President Joyce Esther, St. Cloud State University President Robin Wacker, lots has been said about St. Cloud University here today, Senior Vice Chancellor for Academic and Student Affairs, Satasha Green-Stevens is here, Vice Chancellor CFO Bill Mackey, Vice Chancellor for Equity and Inclusion, Andriel Dees, Vice Chancellor for Human Resources, Eric Davis, Vice Chancellor for Information Technology, Jackie Bailey, and Chief Audit Officer, Amy Jorgensen. All of us are honored to be here today. Now, much has been mentioned about Nellie Stone Johnson's passions, but I strongly believe that one of her real serious passions was public education. My fellow trustee, Nellie Stone Johnson, served our colleges and universities in three different ways: as trustee to the university board, then the interim higher education board, and finally, Minnesota State College and University Board. Her passion for helping students get, quote, good education for a good job continues to be one of our guiding tenets. Thank you to the Stone Johnson Scholarship Board for keeping her passion alive, for so many of her students. I know many of you worked long and tirelessly to see this day come to fruition, and I thank you for all of your efforts. Congratulations to all of you.
And you just heard education, 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 right? So we're just so thrilled that we have the opportunity today to introduce to you the current principal of Nellie Stone Johnson Elementary School in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Are you going to introduce the kids? And she will introduce the most important role in the crowd, Ms. Wright.
Thank you. So I am so honored to be here today for this great occasion to celebrate Nellie Stone Johnson. When anyone asks me where I'm the principal, I always say I'm the proud principal of Nellie Stone Johnson, because who wouldn't be excited to have their name connected to a woman like Nellie Stone Johnson? So when I told my teachers that I was going to be here, I said, send me the names of some students that could come and join this occasion with me, because after all, the students are the most important part of what we're doing, right? Nellie Stone worked tirelessly. She dedicated over 70 years of her life for students of color. So I brought 11 students with me today. So students, if you can stand up, they're a little tired. Our school day ended at 2:30. So I brought 11 students with me, and they are doing their job, and they are working. And they are persevering through this school year, and they are working very hard. It started with a dream, with Nellie Stone, with a dream and hard work, and that's what I want them to know, that with dreams and hard work, you can do anything and be anything you want to be. So if you guys will wave, you guys wave at them. I know you're tired. And our bus has been waiting for a little while. Like I said, our day is at 2:30. We have Nicole, our social worker. Amir, can you wave? Devante, I can't see your faces all back there. I have Queen, Hassan, Sudi. Jalicia, are you still awake? They were back there napping. Jacob, Sin. Who am I? Freddie. So thank you all once again for inviting me for this occasion, and I look forward to partnering with you, because it takes a village and it takes all of you to do the hard work of educating our young ones. So thank you once again. Oh, and also I have my associate superintendent, Laura Cavender, here with me, and I have Dr. Harris Berry, who's over the associate superintendents. So thank you for coming to support our school and our students. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much. And you had the opportunity to pick up a Nellie bookmark that came from Nellie Stone Johnson School. We started these back when we ran a Nickels for Nellie campaign, when we were collecting money. And so the kids got involved, and we collected money for the Nickels for Nellie campaign, and they'll take some of those back to the school with them so they can share them again. I also want to remind you that Tamrat held up, I think, Nellie's book, and the book about Nellie is a wonderful read. You'll learn a lot, and you'll appreciate a lot about Minnesota, its history, and her history. It is on sale at the registration desk from the Minnesota Historical Society, and so those are available. The other thing is that we now are going to do two things. First of all, two members of the Nellie's family are going to come up here and just basically say hi and ask their family members to stand up. Then the family members first are going to have the opportunity to go right behind me into the north portico. That's right behind me. And in the north portico is where the shrouded statue of Nellie Stone Johnson is. Now, if we're going to allow the family to go first, the TV camera. Eat and so for the introduce the family, Peg Carpenter, you gonna introduce him? And Lucas, two of you wanna.
Hi, Judy Olson is supposed to be up here with us also, my sister-in-law. First, I'd like the family to stand. We're half the room. Thank you. This is Nellie's, I have to count. Three times. We do have a fourth here. But this is Nellie's three-time nephew, and as she would call us, she didn't like the word great. She called us grand. And we were to address her in the same way. She was grand. So Lucas is going to say a few words.
Hello. Wow. It's an amazing moment. We just want to thank a couple people. So on behalf of the Nellie Stone Johnson family, I would like to say thank you for all that supported this endeavor. We want to give a special shout out to the state of Minnesota for recognizing and honoring, memorizing Nellie's name and putting her in the Capitol building. Also, we want to give a shout out to the unions for making this possible and pushing it over the top. We couldn't have done it without you. Our family is deeply indebted to the lifers of Nellie Stone Johnson. we are going to continue her legacy the best way we know how to basically keep her voice alive, keep her name alive. We started a preparatory school a couple years back. It's called Minnesota Preparatory Academy. So it's a high school preparatory academy for the gifted and talented. We're going to start a scholarship fund in her name to help the kids before they get to college. So I know we already do the college scholarship fund. So that's going to be something that we're going to honor her with every year. We think that is very important just because she stressed education so much. We want to send a special shout out to Peggy Carpenter, my aunt who was just up here, and my mom who represents our family and Stone Johnson Scholarship Fund. And we thank you guys for coming out, and we really appreciate it.
Thank you, everybody. And in closing, Louise is going to have a few comments. I just want everybody know the website, nelliestone.org. So if you're interested in finding out more details about the scholarship, about Nellie, we're always adding to it. And please feel free to check in on it and observe the students we've honored and worked with the last couple of years. And finally, there was one person I forgot to recognize. Most of you know this is a legal process, so we need a legal advisor. So a former student that worked with me back in the 1990s, his name's Harley Brown. Harley, he's at Byron and Fredrickson. He was our legal advisor, and he helped us through this process. Harley, wave your hand up, let me see you. Thanks, Harley, for all your hard work.
Okay, so this educator is reminding you, first it's teach and then reteach, repeat, right? So family, you guys go ahead, stand up and head that direction, follow Peg. And while they are going to have first look, first of all, Governor, will you go with them?
Yes,
and count Dan, Lieutenant Governor, and do the count as good coach. And while they are moving and the governor is counting down to removing the veil, removing the cover, Labor Chorus, lead us in.
Maybe we're count down?
Yep.
We need one more.
Wait, another little one to help. There she comes.
I'm not a producer.